At the moment, I believe that all our income levels are very low. I don't think that this is a bumper harvest for many people. There's a downfall when it comes to our income generations. But remember, we are still living in that we have not put on our side of the wants, maybe on a hold. We are still in need of ABCD. So you realize that whatever we have generated compared to what we want to do with it, for sure it is not enough. And I believe this is the life we have all been living, that at no moment can you say you have got more than your needs. Yeah, usually the resources less than what we are, for example, waiting to satisfy with that particular resource. And as a result of that, what do? You have to make a good choice. You have to think of what you satisfy today as you await for maybe tomorrow, to now consider again what to satisfy. That you have to prioritize. Do I go to school or do I build a house today? You can say, if I go to school, for example, use your resource into furthering education, you're likely to have a better job tomorrow where you can earn more, and that way you can now consider to build a school or rather a house or any other kind of a building you want to have in your life. So you are prioritizing in the name of today. Whatever you have is not enough. So I choose to do ABCD. The others can actually await. And when my resource will have built, then I can now consider to satisfy those that I had actually forgone. And what happens is there arises a concept of three items which are always connected. Number one is what we call the choice. Number two is what we call number one, we have the choice. And number two, we have the term we call opportunity cost. The opportunity cost. So these are two items which you need to look at, but we cannot choose if there was no scarcity. It is the one that is driving us into now making a choice. So here comes, let's see the connection, resources in the society. And actually all the societies, when I talk of a society, I mean a nation, I mean an economy. So a society would have resources which are not enough. To an individual, our wants are overwhelming whatever is available to satisfy them. We normally say resources are limited, but the human wants are unlimited. So as a result of the scarcity, we are now bound to make a choice. It is out of the resource were not enough that we now have to make a choice. And when we choose, it means we have not satisfied everything. What happens? It comes that I have forgone a particular item. I have not built that house that I wanted to build. There's that particular element, there's a particular one that has actually been forgone. And as you forego a particular want, there arises what we call opportunity cost. You see the connection I'm trying to bring in here. Due to the scarcity of the resources, they were not enough, yeah, to satisfy all our wants. And when we say something is scarce, it is there. What is happening, it is not adequate enough to satisfy our wants. And what we are saying is not enough, it is there, but it is not enough, are the resources in our society. Then we make a choice. We choose to satisfy A, we have not satisfied B. Because of you choosing and another one has been forgone, okay, the value of benefit that is actually forgone becomes what we call the opportunity cost. I repeat, as a result of the scarcity of the resources, one has to make a choice on what to do. As a consumer, for example, you choose to consume A and so you forgo B. If you have forgone your B, then the value of benefit that you could have enjoyed if you had bought the B, since you have forgone it, its value becomes the opportunity cost of you now choosing, for example, to go for A. So opportunity cost arises in the name of we have chosen, and why we were bound to choose is as a result of the resources were not enough. They were actually scarce. They were there, but they were not enough to actually satisfy all our wants at a go. So people in the society, be it the consumers or even the producers or even the government, has to make a good choice. And before we make a choice, we normally analyze, what is that that I'm losing on the other end? What is that I didn't do that could have given me a particular benefit? That is, you look at the concept of opportunity cost. And therefore, opportunity cost guides us in various decision-making processes. For example, as a consumer, you should forgo an item that you know has a lower value than what you're choosing to buy. I repeat, as a consumer, you choose to go for a particular property or particular product or a particular item whose value of benefit is higher. Therefore, you forgo that which has a lower benefit. And when you are looking at the opportunity cost, then opportunity cost of the element you have now chosen to buy should actually be low, because opportunity cost, we are saying, it is a value of benefit attached to whatever you have chosen to forgo. Number two, if it is a producer, you have got different lines of production that you'd want to undertake. Unfortunately, resources to do these businesses are not enough. So what do? You evaluate the benefit that you're likely to get from a particular production, and that which you should be choosing should be the one to guarantee you higher benefit, so you forgo those which were likely to have given you, for example, lower benefit. Again, the term opportunity cost guides as a producer that always choose to go for a production whose opportunity cost is actually a low. Again, if it is a government, there are quite a number of projects that it would want to take for the people of the nation. On behalf of the society, what should the government do? Choose as the government to go for a production, to go for a project that is in line with the development of a society, and so should be beneficial to as many people as possible. Forgo such projects which you know they are likely to touch lives of very few in the society. For example, as a government, do we construct a highway, yeah, or do we increase the salaries by our maybe MPs in the region? Which is the best kind of a project for us to consider in the society? Do we do A? Do we do B? The point is, you always go for a project where the opportunity cost is low. And those are the main uses of the opportunity cost, where we are saying economics is all about decision making, in that resources are not actually enough. As we engage to as many economic activities as possible, we want to understand, why am I doing A and not B? It's not just for the sake of it. It's because you must have analyzed its benefit, and so choosing to go for where there is higher benefit and foregoing that which has a lower benefit. Number two, I would want us to think about Because we are making a choice, and the drive is by these resources were not enough to satisfy what are the human wants. Very important to look at this when it comes to economics. And human wants are actually all the things that we normally desire in our life. There are quite a number of things that you feel maybe I would want to. So during our free time, I've done a small analysis about what are human wants. They are all about that which you want to have in your life. They are usually addressed because they go on and on and on, sometimes even growing to be larger in terms of how many they are as we continuously live our life. And as long as a human being is living, so will always be some wants in the society by those human beings. Again, the resources that we are talking of are actually scarce, but generally, as much as they are limited, they'll always have different uses. That these resources will be required to do so many things, it's only that they are not actually adequate enough to do all that we want to do. Our exercise for today on the term human wants here, I would want you to highlight maybe more than five characteristics about human wants in a particular society. Again, when we are making a choice as producers in the society, there are three economic questions that you normally ask. What is that that I am producing? How do I go about its production? And for whom am I producing for? These are normally called the three fundamental economic questions that each and every producer should address before making a choice on what to produce in the society. And I've tried to explain the meaning of those three fundamental economic questions on this particular document. Then again, there is always the problem of, are we efficiently producing? And when we have produced, are we distributing the products, for example, in a manner that is actually going to benefit as many people as possible? And our exercise for today, again, I want us to look at the way our Kenyan government does distribute and allocate the resources, especially in line with the needs by the society members. And I want you to find out whether it is efficient or it is actually a way that we can say it actually achieves what we call equity in our society. And there's a problem when it comes to such resources not being enough, then it means there'll always be what we call the economic problems arising in the society. The basic economic problem is about the scarcity of the resources, which means we'll not be able to do as we'd want. It means we'll not be able to achieve what we want to fight the problems, to fight, for example, poverty in the society. And as a result of the scarcity of resources, then we have the backwardness of the society. A very good example is like what we see in our country, let's say Kenya. Then again, during our free time, try and distinguish between the two branches. Each one of them deals with what? The microeconomics as well as the macroeconomics. So we'll stop there for today.